We are very pleased to hear now your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much again for inviting me today. And I'm going to show you part of my PhD work that was published a few months ago in Nature Medicine with the title Nicotine Reverses Hypofrontality in Animal Models of Addiction and Schizophrenia. So schizophrenia is a chronic psychotic mental disorder that affects about 1% of people, and it is associated with substantial morbidity and mortality. A combination of genetic and environmental factors plays a key role to the development of this disorder. And it is characterized by several symptoms, including positive symptoms such as delusions or hallucinations, negative symptoms such as social withdrawal, and cognitive symptoms. The neuropathology of schizophrenia remains obscure. However, advances in neuroimaging studies, genetic studies, and also postmortem brain studies led to the identification of specific neuropathological hallmarks, such as reductions in brain volume, altered brain connectivity, hypofrontality, impaired GABA neurotransmission, and of great importance, of course, the dopamine and glutamate hypotheses. So a major genome-wide association study has identified 108 schizophrenia-associated genetic loci. Among them, the gene cluster that contains the alpha-3, alpha-5, and beta-4 genes coding for the alpha-3, alpha-5, and beta-4 nicotinic acetylcholine receptor subunits. Interestingly, this same gene cluster is associated with risk to habitual smoking, and among the most notable polymorphisms, it is the polymorphism RS169-69968, that from now on I will call alpha-5 SNP, that leads to a substitution of an aspartic acid to asparagine to the position 398 of the human alpha-5 subunit. As you can see here, the aspartic acid residue is very well conserved among species, from humans to non-human primates, birds, rodents, and even amphibia, implying its functional importance. Concerning the frequency of this SNP, it is present to 37 to 43% of European and Middle Eastern populations. You should see here the white segment of the pies. However, it is not common to Asians, Africans, or Native Americans. So briefly, to review the expression of the alpha-5 nicotinic subunit in the brain, as you can see, it is present in multiple brain areas. My studies focus on the cortex, and more specifically to the prefrontal cortex, where we have the presence of the alpha-4, beta-2, alpha-5, and alpha-7 nicotinic subunits. The nicotinic acetylcholine subunits can assemble in pentameric combinations and can form different homopentameric or heteropentameric receptors. This broad diversity in distribution in the brain also implies functional differences among different nicotinic receptors. So why prefrontal cortex? The prefrontal cortex plays a major role in cognitive functions such as decision-making, attention, working memory, social behavior, emotion, and access to consciousness. It exhibits spontaneous default activity, and it is believed that disruptions in the prefrontal cortex activity is a main feature of psychiatric disorders such as schizophrenia. The nicotinic receptors activate the prefrontal cortex in a layer-specific manner. You can see that in the superficial layers, we have expression of nicotinic receptors only by interneurons, whereas in the deeper layers, we have expression of nicotinic receptors by both pyramidal cells and interneurons. So several labs, including work in our lab, showed that knockout mice for defined nicotinic receptor subunits are characterized by prefrontal cortex-associated deficits, such as attentional performance and social interaction deficits. So we developed the alpha-5 SNP mouse, the mouse that carries the human polymorphism in the alpha-5 subunit. And we aimed first to characterize, to test these mice for behaviors associated to schizophrenia, and also to study the impact of this variant to the neuronal and circuitry mechanisms underlying cognitive deficits. So it is known that a common feature of schizophrenia, it is impaired social ability. For this reason, we chose the three-chamber social interaction test, that it is an acceptable test to study the social ability of rodents. So the mouse of interest is placed in the chamber and can show preference for either a social partner, another mouse, or an inanimate target, for example, a plastic toy. As you can see from our data, the alpha-5 SNP mice showed exhibited impaired social ability in comparison to wild-type littermates, that they showed a clear preference for the social target. These deficits in social ability cannot be attributed to genotype effects on activity or exploratory time because the total time that the mice spend in the exploratory zones and the locomotor activity were the same between wild-type littermates and alpha-5 SNP mice. We further wanted to test these mice for deficiencies in the prepulse inhibition task. The PPI task measures the ability of an animal to inhibit its startle in response to an acoustic tone when this is preceded by a lower intensity stimulus. Deficiencies in the PPI task are a measure of impaired sensorimotor gating and are observed in several human neuropsychiatric disorders, including schizophrenia. So we found that the alpha-5 SNP mice exhibit decreased PPI in a range of intensities, suggesting that sensorimotor gating is disrupted because of the alpha-5 variant. The major question we asked then, it was how the alpha-5 human polymorphism contributes to the cellular and circuit mechanisms underlying the pathology. To answer this question, I'm using the two-photon imaging technology, since it is a powerful tool to study the brain because of focal plane excitation and also deep penetration of tissue. On the right, I'm showing you a video that starts with a two-dimensional stacks from the brain surface until deep in the mouse cortex, up 750 microns. And it is followed by a 3D reconstruction to show the full structure. As you can see, we have excellent resolution in order to study the brain. specifically to analyze neuronal activity, a few details concerning the technique I'm using. In order to have access in the mouse brain, I'm performing a chronic cranial window, and I inject the genetically encoded calcium indicator GCAM6F in the prelimbic area of the prefrontal cortex. Then I cover the cranial window with a cover glass. I build up with dental cement, and also I'm using a specific metal bar that will help me head fix the mouse for the imaging sessions. So as I mentioned, the mice, they are awake while imaging, they are head fixed, and they are habituated to the imaging environment by handling and training for at least 4 sessions before actually perform the imaging experiment. So I'm showing you here a video of the activity of pyramidal cells in layer 2-3 of the prefrontal cortex. So you can see flashing, firing neurons. The analysis of this data is performed offline. First of all, we are doing image stabilization, and then the regions of interest. I'm showing you here some examples of selected cells. They are selected using ImageJ, and we can plot the change in the fluorescence over time. We have developed a toolbox in MATLAB that it is an automated way of detecting calcium, spontaneous calcium transients, as you can see in red, and we use the convolution in order to translate calcium transients into spikes per minute. So I recorded the pyramidal cell activity in wild-type mice, in knockout mice for the alpha-5 subunit, and mice carrying the human polymorphism. I'm showing you here representative examples of the activity of pyramidal cells. And as you can see from our data, the alpha-5 knockout mice, they showed decreased activity in comparison to the wild-type mice, whereas the activity of the alpha-5 SNP mice was intermediate between the wild-type and the alpha-5 knockout mice. Just as a parenthesis, to review the synthesis of a disinhibitory control in the prefrontal cortex, it has been shown in multiple neocortical areas, including the prefrontal cortex, that activation of the VIP interneurons, the vasoactive intestinal polypeptide interneurons, lead to inhibition of somatostatin and parvalbumin interneurons that they end up disinhibiting the pyramidal cells. So to come back to the experimental data in layer 2-3 of the prefrontal cortex, an explanation for this reduced activity in the knockout and in the SNP mice comes from the differential expression of nicotinic receptors in distinct interneuron types. The alpha-5 nicotinic subunits are expressed in superficial layers by the VIP interneurons. So by knocking out the alpha-5 or by having the SNP, the VIP interneurons can no longer inhibit efficiently the somatostatin and parvalbumin interneurons, that they end up inhibiting the pyramidal cells more at the end, and that's why we hypothesized that we see this reduced activity. In addition to that, we have the expression of the alpha-7 nicotinic subunits in somatostatin and parvalbumin interneurons, whereas the beta-2 nicotinic subunits, they are expressed only by somatostatin interneurons. to further study this simple circuit, I used knockout mice for the alpha 7 or the beta 2 nicotinic subunits. And as you can see, the pyramidal cell activity of the knockout mice was increased in comparison to the wild type activity. So a reasonable question is, because the alpha 5 nicotinic receptors are expressed also in pyramidal cells of deeper layers, a reasonable question is if this phenomenon that we are recording in layer 2-3 of the prefrontal cortex is specific for this layer. So to answer this question, we crossed knockout mice for the alpha 5 subunit with GADCRI mice, mice where the CRI recombinase was under the GAD promoter, and we obtained the alpha 5 knockout GADCRI mice. So then by injecting a conditional lentivirus, I was able to re-express either the alpha 5 wild type subunit or the alpha 5 SNP subunit only in the interneurons of layer 2-3 in a prefrontal cortex, and I recorded the pyramidal cell activity. So as you can see in these mice, the baseline activity of pyramidal cells, again, the alpha 5 knockout mice, they show reduced activity in comparison to wild type. Whereas when we re-express the alpha 5 wild type subunit, the activity is restored to the levels of wild type. Whereas when we re-express the alpha 5 SNP, the activity is intermediate between wild type and alpha 5 knockout. With the same logic, because the beta 2 nicotinic subunits are also expressed in other layers of the prefrontal cortex, we use the lentiviral vector for the re-expression of the beta 2 wild type subunit, and I injected in layer 2-3 of the prefrontal cortex of beta 2 knockout mice, and as you can see, the beta 2 knockout mice injected with the lentiviral vector had no significant difference in the activity compared to wild type mice. So I told you that nicotinic receptors modulate prefrontal cortex activity through inhibitory neurons. But then we aimed to directly record from the different interneuronal types while we have reduced expression of the alpha 5 nicotinic receptors. So to do that, we use the lentiviral vector that expresses the Cas9. So we use the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. So the lentiviral vector expresses the Cas9 and also a guide RNA that targets the alpha 5 subunit. And we injected in layers 2-3. And I recorded the activity of the VIP interneurons. So I used the VIP CRI TD tomato line, and by injecting a CRI-dependent AAV vector to express the GCAM6F, I could record directly from VIP interneurons. I should mention that as a control, the control mice were injected with a lentiviral vector that expresses Cas9 and a guide RNA that does not recognize any human, mouse, or rat gene. So we found that in the case of the VIP mice injected with the lentivirus CRISPR alpha 5, the activity of these interneurons was robustly decreased in comparison to the control VIP mice. Similarly, we aimed to record the activity of the parvalvumin interneurons using the PV-Cre line. And surprisingly, we did not find any significant difference between the mice that they were injected with the lentiviral CRISPR alpha 5 in comparison to PV control mice. In addition to that, we then aimed to record the somatostatin interneurons, and we found that the activity of the somatostatin interneurons in the case of the CRISPR alpha 5 injection was robustly increased in comparison to control mice. And as a final control, we aimed to record from pyramidal cells in wild-type mice and compare the activity between the CRISPR and the control mice. And as you can see, the pyramidal cell activity in the case of the CRISPR-injected mice was decreased. So to make a small summary of what I showed you right now, I showed you that nicotinic receptors modulate prefrontal cortex activity through a hierarchical inhibitory circuit, and alpha-5 subunit plays a major role in controlling the VIP-mediated disinhibition via somatostatin interneuron inhibition of pyramidal neurons. So I showed you that alpha-5 SNP mice exhibit hypofrontality. It is worth mentioning that in humans, the alpha-5 SNP is associated with a reduced resting state functional connectivity. There is a discussion whether early smoking, early cigarette smoking, leads to psychosis, or actually smoking is used as a form of self-medication, considering that smoking is extremely common in people with schizophrenia. Based on the evidence that nicotine obtained by smoking improves some cognitive abilities and mitigates certain schizophrenic symptoms of schizophrenia, we aimed to administer nicotine in wild-type mice and in mice carrying the alpha-5 human polymorphism. Here I'm showing you the experimental design. So as explained before, I performed the cranial window and inject the calcium indicator. The mice are trained for four sessions. And then 1 month post-injection, we can image the baseline activity. And then we implanted osmotic mini pumps for the infusion of either saline or nicotine. And the dose of nicotine was selected to maintain a plasma concentration analogous to that observed to smokers. So I'm showing you here 7 days post-implantation of the mini pump, 1 week infusion of saline or nicotine. And as you can see in the wild-type mice that were infused with nicotine, the pyramidal cell activity is increased in comparison to the control mice. Whereas in the case of the alpha-5 SNP mice infused with nicotine, the activity was more or less restored to the levels of the wild type. Following the pyramidal cell activity over time, 2 weeks post-implantation of the mini pump, you can see that still the wild-type nicotine, the wild-type mice infused with nicotine, they showed increased activity, whereas the alpha-5 SNP mice infused with nicotine, they showed the same levels of activity with the control mice. So we showed that chronic nicotine can restore the hypofrontality in alpha-5 SNP mice. To further test this and elucidate the mechanism behind this restoration of activity in alpha-5 SNP mice. We administered with the same exact experiment, with the same protocol, using osmotic mini pumps and the same dose of nicotine. We administered nicotine or saline in somatostatin CRE mice, and we recorded the somatostatin, the activity of somatostatin in the neurons. And as you can see, in the case of the nicotine-infused mice, the somatostatin activity was reduced in comparison to the control. That makes us think that desensitization of the beta-2 nicotinic receptors expressed by somatostatin interneurons might lead to a restoration of pyramidal cell activity to the control levels in the case of the alpha-5 SNP mice. So overall, the alpha-5 SNP mice exhibit prefrontal cortex-associated behavioral deficits. The alpha-5 SNP and the alpha-5 knockout mice exhibit decreased pyramidal cell activity. And acetylcholine, endogenous acetylcholine, distinctly recruits specific interneuron types to control the pyramidal cell activity in a prefrontal cortex by differential expression of specific nicotinic receptor subunits. Also, chronic nicotine is able to restore the hypofrontality observed in alpha-5 SNP mice, and this data paved the way to new pharmacotherapeutic strategies to enhance, for example, alpha-5 nicotinic receptor or diminish beta-2 nicotinic receptor activity in the prefrontal cortex. So I would like to thank all the collaborators that participated to this work from the Institut Pasteur, the École Normale Supérieure, the University of Colorado, and the University of Göttingen. And that work was part of my PhD that was funded by the Stavros Niarchos Foundation. And also I would like to thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to discuss with you any questions.